Want to say welcome to Lakewood Christian Fellowship on this Sunday morning. Isn't it good to just have temperatures in the 70s instead of near 100? I don't know anybody else. I was kind of getting a little tired of that. As we sing this morning to the God who makes everything, including the weather, who is in charge, who is great, we want to focus in on that this morning as we've gathered here. Who God is, how much He loves us, what He has done for us. You're going to see a line in this next song, sing with us, that He is the one who breaks the chains. He's the one who sets us free. So as we concentrate on Him this morning, as we open our eyes to who He is this morning, bring your chains, bring whatever it is that's burning you right now, what's bringing you down, so that He can lift you up as we continue to worship Him this morning.
Ourselves,
Are we bowing before the Lion and the Lamb this morning? See, I don't know about you, I just know in my life, whenever I am worshiping God, whenever I'm following Him, whenever I'm reading my Bible, whenever I'm praying, I sense His presence. I know that He is there in my life, and I know He's fighting the battles. He's setting me free. He's breaking the chains. I also know that when I don't do those things, when I don't have my quiet time in the morning, my time with God in the Bible, I know when I'm not bringing to Him my struggles, that it seems like it's the enemy who gets the victory. So it's time to bring that back, to bring ourselves back, even if it's right here, right now, to bow before God, to bow before the Lion and the Lamb and say, God, you're greater than I am. God, you have it, I don't, but you do. And so I'm gonna bring to you the battles that I'm facing, the war that's going on in my life, the struggles that are happening. God, I'm gonna bring it to you. And I'm gonna believe in faith that God, you will give the victory as I bring my life before you, as I bring what's going on before you. I bow before you, knowing that you have the victory.
No weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. We'll be right back.
God. We've come to you. We've brought to you the struggles. God, we've brought to you what's going on in our lives, the cares, the worries, the concerns. We brought them before you because, God, you said that if we'll give it to you, you will win the victory. So, God, we're praying in faith right now. We're singing in faith right now that you are the God that we can look to, that you are the God with the answers and the solutions, that you are the God with the healing, you are the God with the power. You are the God who can take our lives, transform us, change us, save us. That's who you are. And so, God, we sing in faith right now. With everything that we have, we're going to look to you.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do.
I will love you, Lord, my rock.
worship God, who is the one who loves and cares for us, who gives the invitation, come before my presence. Come before me. Know that I am with you, that I am for you.
Yeah.
those of you who know the rest of that song. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted high above all gods. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods.
So let's sing I Exalt Thee one more time.
I exalt thee.
Right now, that you are in this place. So God, we call upon you, first of all exalting you because you are above everything. You've made all things. By you and for you they were made, including us, God. And so we just lift you up and we say, God, here we are, giving back to you what is due your name. Honor and glory, power and dominion to you, O God. We lift up our praise like incense. It's a sweet smell to you. Thank you, God, that we're able to come before you and worship. God, thank you for your presence in this place. God, we come before you, glad to be in your presence. Lord, what a privilege, what a joy. Cleanse us, God. Take out all that is of this world and replace it with you. God, fill our spirits, for we need you. We are in a dry and weary land. Even though we've had physical rain all around us this weekend, God, our spirits, our souls are dry without you. So God, thank you that you've rained down your spirit upon us this morning. God, we drink you in. With joy. Thank you, God, for being here in this place. I pray, God, that in everything that we do, we will realize that we are in the presence of the Creator of the universe, who loves us, who gave his very life for us, who has forgiven us, set our feet upon a rock when we were in the mud and the mire. You've broken chains, you've healed bodies. And yet that work still needs to be done. So God, we cry out to you, who is the highest above all, and bring our lives to you and ask that you work within us. Give us that which you know we need, that you know that you want to pour out on us according to your will, according to your abundance, according to who you are. Let us continue to worship you. Thank you, God, that you are here in this place. I pray that we will bring to you everything that is not of you and lay it at your feet. In the name of Jesus. Amen. So, Mary, you have kids' time, right?
Yes.
Okay, why don't you come on up and you're the. I'm going to see if I can lower this. I don't know. Do you need the table or the stand? Okay. Honey, would you grab that table? So, how do you transition from that to this? I don't. God's presence is good no matter what we do. You know, we were praying this morning at 10 o'clock in our prayer time, but it was Jesus himself who said, "Let the little children come unto me," and that we need to be just like these children to receive him in faith. So we're going to continue our worship in a different way, as Mary has something to share with the children. So I'm glad you're sharing.
Okay, that will work. Yep. Okay. A little more? Okay. Okay, very good. So, I have got something that I want to share with you guys. First of all, I want to know, have ever any of you been impatient? Oh, what does that mean? That's kind of hard. That's kind of a big word for some of us, isn't it? Okay, so let me tell you a story about my friend Chad, okay? So guess what, guys? It's 11:11. I guess we need to pray. Father God, we just ask, Lord, that you would be with us. Father, that you would help us to understand all that we have to say and hear and learn from you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so my friend Chad, he is in this picture right here. Now, does he look happy to you? No, he does not look at all happy. In fact, he is very unhappy with his mom because his mom said they could go swimming today, and he is all ready. And his mom said, just another minute. But he feels like it's been at least 15 or 20 minutes. When really it's only been one or two. But he finally called up, "Mom, aren't you ready yet?" Because Mom was upstairs getting his little sister ready to go. And she said, "Just a minute." And he mumbled out his breath, "If she really wanted to, she could hurry up." And his mom heard something from upstairs and said, "Chad, I can't hear you when you mumble like that." "Oh, it's nothing. I'm just going to go wait in the car." And he went out and he waited in the car. So do you think that Chad has the right attitude? No, not at all. In fact, here's that word I was talking about. And it's a big word. It's impatience, and that's getting angry or upset when you have to wait. We don't like to wait, do we? In fact, sometimes when we wait, have you ever done this? Yeah, pouting, being silently upset when something doesn't go your way. Can anyone agree with me that they've ever done that? I sure have. In fact, I'm going to just share a funny little story. I was getting this lesson ready this morning, but this kind of came on a surprise because I wasn't supposed to be sharing today. And I was trying to write with my pen, and my pen didn't work. And I, and guess what? God immediately said, "Mary, are you being patient?" Ooh, all of us have trouble. Sometimes we have trouble being patient. Patience is a willingness to wait without becoming angry or upset. God says in his holy word, the Bible, "Be patient with them all." Ooh. That means we're supposed to be patient with mom and dad. and with our brother and sister, and with the lady in front of us at the grocery store that's counting out her pennies and we want to get going. All of that is the kinds of things that God says we need to be patient about. And when we are patient, guess what? We find another, this is a fun word, we find joy. Being happy in our heart because God is in control. And so maybe it's not the time we were thinking. Maybe we aren't leaving for swimming as early as we thought we would. But if God is in control, then that means that whatever it is that happens is exactly the way it's supposed to be. That's what he wants us to do. So I'm just going to share from the book of Psalms. I love the book of Psalms. Do you know that the book of Psalms are like poems? Some of them were actually written to music. And this one says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there is any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Now, I know grievous is kind of a hard word, but what that means is doing anything that is a thought, a word, or something we do that makes God sad or breaks his law, right? We also call that sin. God doesn't want us to sin. He wants us to listen and do as he calls us to do. So let's try and do that this week, okay? When we are tempted to be impatient, whether it's the pen that doesn't work or mom not taking us where we want to go when we're ready, let's try to be patient this week, okay? Thank you, guys.
Hey, Mary, I got the message when my wife isn't ready on time. I need to be patient. So I'm going to give you a heads up on something that we're doing a little bit different this morning. Originally, we thought about passing the offering plates again, but I forgot to ask people to do that. So we're actually not going to do that. But I do want to prepare you for a couple of offerings. One of the things that we talked about in previous times is that really once a month we take up a couple of different offerings. Now, you might be thinking, wait a minute, that church just wants all my money. No, we don't. Well, yeah, we do. So make the check out to Mark Howington, H-O-W. No, just kidding. So I'm going to give you a heads up that we are going to take a couple of different offerings today. And I'll tell you why in a moment. Well, I'll tell you why now, then I'll give you a chance to prepare. We have something called the Grace Fund here in this church. And what we do with the Grace Fund is we become aware of people who have needs within our church family and sometimes even with the outside of our church family. And we are able to then use the monies in that Grace Fund to give them food if they need it, or gas. Sometimes Pastor Jeff Pies, when he was here, would meet people at the gas station and sometimes would help them fill up their car because they called the church and said, I can't even get to work right now. And so that's what we do with the Grace Fund. And then, of course, we take up another offering, which basically keeps the lights on in the church. And, for example, Chavo gets a little money for coming here. And when we had the interim pastor, we were paying the pastor, and eventually we'll pay a full-time pastor. So that's why we do two different offerings, because we want to make sure that we don't mix those monies up, if that makes sense. So I'm just going to ask you to prepare and just ask God, do you want me to give? And what we're going to do, because we don't have somebody to pass the plates, is this plate right here is going to be for the Grace Fund. Okay, so if you want to give to the Grace Fund anytime during the service, just feel free to come on up and put Grace Fund in that plate. And that plate over there, we're going to have just for the general offering. And then don't forget that you can also give online to both of those. And you if you want to give to the Grace Fund, you can actually go online and say, Grace Fund. And you can do a pull-down menu and give it to the Grace Fund. And again, the reason we're doing this is because even right now, there are people within our church family who are struggling financially. Some have been out of work. Some have had the combination of out of work and health problems. And so we want to be able to, as a church, give to people because that's what God calls us to do. But we also need to make sure we keep the lights on in the church and do that. So just want to prepare you now if you are making out a check. If you just if you want it to go to the Grace Fund, just write Grace Fund in the bottom of the check. And thanks. And don't feel obligated. Even Paul said, hey, we're not giving out of an obligation. We're giving because we want to bless other people. The other announcement that I have is as I look around the church, and I've noticed, you know, summer times can be a little light in attendance, but next Sunday is actually July 4th. And so I actually have a question for us to ponder. Do we want to open as a church on July 4th? And I guess maybe to help us make that decision, what I want to ask you is, are you planning on being here July 4th? And if you are, raise your hand. So I've got, looks like maybe about, all right, I'm going to say that's enough. So we'll be here next Sunday. And just so you're aware, we do not have a guest speaker next Sunday, so we're going to have an extended time of prayer and worship, and we're going to pray for our nation. What better time to pray for our nation than on July 4th? So come for that. The other thing that I want to offer for Mary, in fact, Mary, if you want to come up here, you're welcome to again for the Good News Club. Okay. Well, here's what I do know. In July, for the Good News Club, we have the Adventure Club coming. So we're going to have several days, July 13th through 15th, where there's going to be it's basically VBS on the run. So VBS on the road. And we may need some volunteers to help with that. Also, here at this church service on July 18th, do I have that right? Okay, July 18th, we're going to have the speaker who heads up the Good News Club for this area. Am I right? Okay. A Child Evangelism Fellowship, okay, come to share for the service. He's going to be our guest speaker that day. And then after the service, and again, this is July 18th, we're going to have a potluck. So feel free to bring some food to share, and we'll give you more details. Say that again. Meat provided by the church. So when we say the blessing, we can say, good Lord, good meat, good food, let's eat. There you go. Okay. All right, good. So, and see Mary if you want to volunteer. And I have one more short announcement. Sorry, announcements are going a little longer than I intended. But we are in need of volunteers, not only from Mary, but in the back. When everybody turn around and look at the back. You see Bob there. Bob's been very faithful. Bob's been coming almost every Sunday to run the sound. And I will tell you something about Bob. Before Bob ran the sound for us, he'd never run a soundboard before. And he kind of got a little bit of training as Bob and I were both in Celebrate Recovery, and I kind of helped him learn how to run the soundboard there. But Bob had never run a soundboard before. And so if Bob can do it, you can do it. And so we desperately need somebody. You notice that Bob actually, he needs relief. He really does, because working back there every Sunday is difficult. Also notice Ben's back there running the camera. Ever since COVID started, Ben's been the only one to run the camera. And you'll notice who's not back there, little Josh. Well, he's not so little anymore. Josh normally runs the music slides, and he's not here this week. So you notice there's actually an empty chair back there, and Bob's doing double duty. He's running sound and the slides. And so I can tell you that if you have an inclination to do any of those, we will train you. I will personally go back there and train you on the soundboard, and it's easier than it looks. It really is. Just ask Bob. And we need somebody to run the camera because, again, all those people that are back there on a regular basis are there every Sunday. And when they're not here, there's a hole there. And so we really could use some volunteers. So if you have any inclination at all and you're thinking to yourself, I can't. Yes, you can. I'll train you. I promise you. We'll teach you how to do it. So I just wanted to throw that out to you. And with that, I'm going to say, Chavo, welcome. Thank you for sharing last week. What a great message. And I can't wait for part two. So let me just pray real quick. God, I pray for Chavo that you will share through him your words for us. Lord, we're fighting battles. And Chavo, through his message last week, started to teach us how we need to be fighters. We need to get our head in the game and the footwork going. And Lord, I'm sure he has more to teach us. So God, open our hearts so that we can learn. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning. How's everybody doing? All right. Let me get this PowerPoint set up. I think I'm just waiting for the. And it looks like I don't have as much time as last week, so I'll have to cut out some things I was planning to say. But that's all right. Let me just get this up and going. Okay, so thank you for having me again. It's great to be back. If you weren't here last week, my name is Chavo, and I am just guest speaking for you all. And last week was Father's Day. Let's see here. That is not the screen that should be up. That's my dream. Yeah, it's my dream car, by the way. Only 300,000. Let's see what. Okay, let's see. There we go. Now we're up and going. Okay, so last week was Father's Day, and I began a series when Joshua asked me to cover down. He said, "Hey, if you could make it to where you kind of make a mini series, so it's back to back." And since it was Father's Day, I actually when I began planning for the message, I didn't really consider it being Father's Day. So when I went back, I was like, "Okay, Lord, what do you want me to speak about? What do you want me to teach?" And it was really a combination of, "Hey, if I was a father and I had children, what would I teach my children if I only had a brief time with them, a little bit of a time?" And I thought, well, hey, you know what? Although the Lord's creation is beautiful in many ways, because of fallen humanity, because of sin, because of many different things, it can be a very ugly place, a very mean place. A place that can just beat you down. And there are things as human beings, as people, that we have to learn in order to be successful, in order to live a healthy, sustainable lives. And I thought, well, hey, given that it's a dangerous place and we have an enemy, right? Someone who doesn't want us to thrive. The Bible says that the enemies come to steal, kill, and destroy. So if you think about someone being out there who wants to steal from you, he wants to steal your happiness. He wants to steal your peace. If you've ever been without peace in life, it's one of the most miserable things to ever endure. He wants to steal your hope, right? He wants to kill you. Not only physically, but mentally and emotionally. He wants to destroy. So if I, as a parent, were thinking, oh, wow, I have kids. I don't in real life. but if I did, and I knew that there is a place that is going to be extremely dangerous, that my children are going to have encounters with a real, real evil, what would I teach them? And I began thinking, okay, well, this is the basics. So I'm going to recap really quick. The last week is online if you wanted to go back and watch it, if you didn't. So I would teach my kids the basics of how to survive. And when you think about it, it's kind of the basics of spiritual warfare. But spiritual warfare, in the way we think about it, isn't as it's portrayed in Hollywood or stories that you might hear. As I mentioned, the sort of power encounters that people have, You know, when you think about demonic activity, when you think about satanic activity. But really, spiritual warfare is something more common than you think. And when you contextualize it into the West, into the United States, our day and age, it looks a lot more of a mental battle, right? The mental health of today's age is an epidemic. You know, it's something that's extremely now a lot more people are talking about. It's on the rise. Things like depression. Things like thoughts of suicide, things like, addiction, substance abuse. You know, there's a lot of things that go on in our head. And spiritual warfare looks a lot more like that in the West, I would say, than it does in other parts of the world where you have these power encounters, where people are elevate off the ground or receive strength enough to, you know, pick up 10 men and, you know, things like this. Incredibly scary encounters, and they do happen. I believe they happen. I know people who've experienced it, but not so much in the West, right? As I talked about last week, it's things like, you know, greed and power and sexual sin and these types of things. These are the types of things that run, I guess, the West, the culture in the West. So, what to do? What would you have to learn? I talked about having a foundation, right? You have to be founded in your belief and what we believe as Christians. I talked about the footwork that you have, meaning you have to be able to move and communicate that belief to other people, but not only to other people, but inside your own self. You have to have head movement. And that's where I stopped last week, the head movement. What does this mental game look like? Well, it looks oftentimes, it looks like the thoughts that you have, the thoughts that keep you up at night. Have you ever not been able to sleep? And you're thinking and you're anxious about something. How am I going to pay this bill? What if this doesn't happen? What if? You know, the what if game. Or maybe it's thoughts about yourself that you have. Oh, man, I'm just so terrible at this. I'll never be able to do this. Or, I can't believe I said that. I'm so stupid, you know. Or I'll never be able to accomplish anything in my life. Or I'm ugly, right? This is the way I look. I can't believe I look like this. Those thoughts that you hear, I'm not willing to say at all times in every way is demonic activity or satanic activity, but in many cases it is. And so that head movement, understanding how that plays out. So this week, I'm going to talk about the last three. I'm going to finish up this week. Breathing. And what does that look like? Well, what's the breath of life? The breath of life is the Holy Spirit of God, right? So I'm going to talk about the Holy Spirit. I'm going to talk about striking. Well, you can have a good defense in this sort of mental game, right? But you also have to know how to attack. How do you attack the thoughts that you have, the emotions that you're feeling? You know, have you ever had someone hurt your feelings? Someone say something to you that maybe, and it always happens when it's someone that you. It always hurts more when it's someone that you love or care about, right? Or you respect. It hurts more. The deeper the relationship, the more it hurts, right? I'm not married, but I know stories of when spouses fight. You know, it's a very, very hard thing. And it kind of hits you in the chest, and it spreads throughout your whole body like a tingly feeling, you know? It hurts. How do you combat that? And then longevity, right? It's not just going to happen once. It's going to happen time and time and time again. Multiple times throughout the day. Throughout your entire life. You'll be like, oh, I know people who have had lives where they really didn't accomplish much, right? And they get into a later stage in life and they realize, oh, wow, I've wasted my whole life. What am I going to do now? What's my worth? What could I possibly accomplish? How can I ever be used by God? Or you know, it's too late for me. This happens a lot, more often than you think. So going throughout life, until the day that you die and meet the Lord, you're gonna be under constant attack from the enemy. It's just gonna happen. You could choose not to believe it, but it, you know, you'll find yourself in situation. I can assure you it'll happen today, later today, sometime. It will happen before you go to bed. So you have to have strength and conditioning to endure a long period of attacks. I shared some verses. I'm going to skip through these. And if you want, I could provide a copy of the PowerPoint for you. So just to get us caught up. Okay. So, and I am rushing because I wanted to get you all out of here around noon. I realized last week I didn't pay much attention to the time. So let me pull it up here. Okay, so what does breathing look like? What does breathing look like when you're under this spiritual attack, this spiritual, emotional, mental attack from the enemy? Well, breathing really is your relationship with the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, you are unable, one, to understand spiritual truths. Two, you have no power against the enemy. You cannot fight the enemy without the Holy Spirit. And people try. I mean, have you ever, you know, the term just pick yourself up by your bootstraps type thing? You know, you try to hold out. Maybe if you're struggling with substance abuse or have a substance abuse condition, you're just like, oh, I'm just gonna muscle my way through it. Maybe 2-3 weeks, a couple months maybe. You know, and then what happens, right? This is why we have the term, oh, he fell off the wagon again, you know. Or maybe it's, you know, I'm not going to get angry today. Right? I'm not going to, you know, snap at my children. I'm not going to do this. Whatever it may be. Paul talks about this in Romans, he talks about this battle that wages within us. There are things we say, oh, I really want to do this. But then he says, the things that I want to do, I don't do. But then the things that I don't want to do, I do them. Well, why is that? You know, so having a relationship with the Holy Spirit is, it's like it's the initiation, the ignition of access. Well, the Bible says that you have access to all the blessings in the heavenly places. And in 1 Corinthians 6:17, this verse to me, I think there are very many few people who have actually grasped this verse and applied it to its maximum potential here on earth. When you really think about what this verse says in terms of the Holy Spirit. It says, but whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. It's pretty simple, but think about it. The God of all creation, the God of all power, the Bible says when you are in Christ, what does that mean? That means, hey, I realize that I'm a sinner, that Jesus died for my sin, that he died on the cross, that he gave his body and his blood for me, that he was buried, and he physically came back to life. That's the gospel. That's what the Bible says. That's what we talked about last week, the foundation. That Jesus died for your sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried according to the scriptures, and that he rose from the dead according to the scriptures. The gospel. That's the foundation, right? It says, but whoever is united with him is one spirit with him. You know, and I kind of completely forgot to do the word study, but if I can remember correctly, the concept that comes out of the words in the Greek, it's basically saying that your spirit is interwoven with God and cannot be separated. Can you think about that? The God of all creation, when you think about, oh, my body is a temple of the Lord. Well, yes, but it means that your spirit and his spirit have become one. That's pretty incredible to think about. To have the Spirit of God as your spirit together. And that is, I believe, the key to not only understanding the scriptures, because that's what the Bible tells us, but it's the key to power over the enemy. Not only over the enemy, but to be empowered to do good. This is why, you know, some people who are they're just very greedy, right? And then and you're just like, wow, that person is so selfish. It's all about them. Me, 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 me. And there's a funny comedian that I'm reminded of just now, and he does this bit where he talks about the me monster, you know. It's all about me, the me monster. And but then what happens when they encounter the living God and their spirit becomes one with them? What God can do is take that greedy person and make them the most giving, the most selfless person. Maybe it's someone who is just extremely angry all the time. Maybe it's because of someone who's hurt them. Maybe it's just, I mean, you know, people get, they say, dealt bad cards all the time, you know? I mean, I've known people who are born into situations, and you're like, wow, that really is terrible. And they didn't have any control over it. It was just what they had been given, right? And they just become this very bitter person. The world is against them, and they have, I mean, you know, unfortunately, they have to learn how to survive, and that usually means being a very unlikable person. But what happens when the Holy Spirit of God comes together with their spirit? They can become the most kind, loving people that you've ever met. But it's not because they did it. It's because the Spirit of God dwells within them. And what does the Bible teach us? Ephesians 3:16, it says, I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being. Right? It's not just power to, like, you know, strength power, like to lift things, or to, you know, physical power, although he can. But it's power, what does the Bible say? To be gracious, to be kind, to be merciful, to be forgiving, to tell the truth, you know, these types of things. One of the most, I guess, hardest things to do is to have self-control. And that's what the Bible says, right? To practice self-control in all that we do. It's extremely difficult, if you've ever tried, to exercise self-control. Not just self-control in what you eat or bad habits or how many of you set more than one alarm? Right, you have to set more than one alarm in the morning. Why? Because you know you're not going to get up. How many of you, I don't know how many of you like, you know, Netflix or your series person or something, but you're late at night, and I know people from my generation or, you know, in college, they know they have to wake up early, they're watching a show, but they're like, oh, just one more episode. I got to get one more episode in. Or, you know, what I don't know. It could be anything that you know that you don't have self-control. Maybe it's drinking coffee. I know people who drink a lot of coffee, you know. But you know, drinking 6 cups of coffee a day isn't good for you. You know, so having that self-control to say, hey, it's just going to be 1 Starbucks today, not 3 or 4. Or, you know, but how do we get there? How do we do that? Or what about if it's a person that you just don't like? Have you ever been around someone? Maybe you've never met them. Maybe, I mean, they just walk into the room and you're like, I don't like that person. For whatever reason. But, you know, that's, something I struggle with is self-control on the road. Because I have a lot of experience in driving, I was a combat driver in the military in Iraq. I've driven semis, I've driven tractors, I've driven a lot in my life, and I look at a vehicle more as a you know, a couple thousand pound weapon than a thing that can transport you to somewhere. If you really think about it, when you're going 70 to 85 miles an hour. Or 80 miles an hour, however fast you drive on the highway, you're only this close from death. I don't understand why people don't realize that. You can die like that when you're on the highway. And so I take it very seriously when people drive erratically. I used to be that way until the Lord softened my heart. But now I have to work on, you know, being angry at other people when I see them doing silly things on the road. But it's the power of God through his spirit in me that can give me the power to overcome that. Not only is the Holy Spirit our power, but he is also someone who teaches. The Bible says, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, is Jesus talking, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. So here in a little bit, when I transition to striking, really teaching has to do with truth. And today, and you know, unfortunately, there are many views on truth, and it's created a lot of problems in our culture and in the West. I mean, around the world, truth is something that's not as valued today as it was. But not just logical truth, right? Not just moral truths or philosophical truths. But really, it's God's truth. And it's God's truth that reflects, you know, eternal truths. And what is God's truth? Well, it's what he's said in his word, you know. And unfortunately, lots of times today, there's this sort of, okay, well, this is a religious truth or, you know, a theological truth, but it doesn't really reflect the scientific truth. So how can the two come together? And that's a different discussion. But it's really what God's truth says. If we're thinking in context of who you are, how are you valued, how you're going to survive in this world, it's what God's truth says about you, about him, your relationship with him together, and what it says about other people and his creation, God's truth. So how can you understand God's truth? Well, the Holy Spirit of God. That's how you understand God's truth. And I'll give you an example. There are really, really smart people, very highly educated and intelligent people, literary experts, historical experts who study the Bible, but they're not believers in it. And they can know the cultural historical context. They could know the original languages, Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek. They can, I mean, maybe they know 7 languages. But you know, there's something that hasn't clicked. And what is that? You know how many people I've seen pick up the Bible and they just like they don't understand what it's saying. It reminds me of one time he was a believer, or is a believer, someone that I knew at one time, and I happened to be studying, you know, in my quiet time, and he wasn't doing his thing, and I looked over, and he had the Bible open like this, and he was just looking at it like this. Like, he had no idea what it was saying. But sometimes that happens, and that happens, I mean, especially if you're reading something like a King James Version or something. I hope the Southern Baptists don't hate me for that. Sometimes the Bible doesn't make sense. Well, how do you get understanding? It's through the Holy Spirit. This is a powerful one, I think, this next verse I'll share. I think, too, because we, as believers in Christ, we can see how other people act and the things that they do. And we want, it could be good intentions. We want to change them. We want to help them understand. We want their lives to be good, right? But then we see how they act and the decisions they make. And you ever want to just pull your hair out at someone? Maybe it's your wayward son, or maybe it's your best friend. Maybe it's a coworker or something. And you're just like, oh, why can't you understand? And you just want to like shake them. And not only this, sometimes you get Christians, quite frankly, well-meaning, well-to-do Christians who are just jerks. And why is that? Because they want to take God's truth and hit the person over the head with it like it's a hammer. And, you know, don't you know that God said, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that? Don't you know that you are a sinner, and the way that you're living is going to bring you to hell? You know, and God bless them, those people on the street corner. They're, you know, street preaching is something that historically has brought revivals. But sometimes people are just jerks, to be honest. ironically and sadly enough, it's Christian to do that. And the reason why I say this is because, you know, if you're talking to someone, you don't know them. You don't know what they've been through. You don't know where they are in life, what they're dealing with. You don't know what they have on their plate. And you go into and you try to invade their life when you don't have permission to do so. When you haven't been given, when you haven't been given their trust. When you haven't entered into a relationship with them, and then you try to share God's truth with them in such a way that is, you know. And why do I say that? Because, you know, it's not your job to convict somebody of sin as Christians. That's not your job. You're not supposed to do that. You know whose lane that is? That's God's lane. And you know how I know that? It says here, when he comes, will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. That's God's job to do that. He's the one who convicts people of their sin, not you. Because it's a lot more simple than that, you know. The Bible says that God has put eternity in our hearts. The Bible says that he's made himself so evident that if you just go outside and look at the stars, he says, if you look at the heavens in Romans, there's something that God has done to make himself undeniable. So, and you know, I gotta kind of move on here, but what I'm saying is, I really don't believe that people don't believe in God, or at least God as he's revealed himself. More often than not, it's one, because they've been hurt. And there's a pain and a suffering that they've experienced that hasn't been explained. and they're angry because of who they believe, or because they believe God to be a certain way, and they have an expectation of him to explain things to them, and they don't receive it. And so they begin to think that God is someone who he isn't. And they choose not to believe in that God, but they don't know who God is really. So people, and I can get into a different discussion about pain and suffering, but what I'm saying is, there is a sense in which God has to do the work. And you know what our job is? We're to be the conduit for that, like the mechanism by which God operates and does things, like a lightning rod, you know. The lightning rod, it's a metal, and it, how the ground and the air work, and it brings, you know, power to this thing. And that's our job as Christians when it comes to sharing the love of Christ with people. And, you know, like I said, I'm going to wrap it up here really quickly. But the all of what I've sort of shared with you is culminating into one sort of action, and that is striking. We've talked about having your fundamentals and belief. You have to know the gospel. You have to be able to share that gospel. You have to be able to understand in your head what is of God and what isn't, and you have to be able to apply that, and you have to be able to have a relationship with God in such a way that he can empower you, that he can teach you. And what does that look like if you are doing well, if you're thriving? Well, that looks like a striking. And striking in the context of boxing or any martial art, really, in my opinion, is of the easier things to do, but it's everything that has to be involved in it that makes it difficult. It's really not a difficult concept, but you have to do it well, and to do it well, it takes a lot of practice. And so what does striking like this in the context of a spiritual lesson look like? Well, it looks like prayer and the word. It's pretty simple. And everything that I've just shared, it can be reduced down to that, prayer and the word. And in boxing, the 1-2 punch is the most basic of the basics that you can get to. However, like I shared last week, when I was in the military, what separated the novice or the sort of lower ranking to the elites was that the elites are those who have mastered the basics. They have mastered the basics in such a way that when you look at it and you say, wow, how did they do that? But it's really nothing more than what you already know. It's just they have learned how to apply it better. And they have practiced it time and time and time and time again to where they don't even have to think about the basics. You ever go into a new job and you're getting trained and it's just so overwhelming? You're like, oh, wow, there's so much information. You have to process it all. And you're like, how am I ever going to learn how to do this? And you know, the first couple of times, you maybe be nervous. You're like, all right, let me figure out how to do this. And then, you know, a couple months, a couple weeks go by, and you realize, oh, wow, I remember when I had a really difficult time with that, you know. And then next thing you know, you get another employee in, and you say, hey, I've been assigned to teach you how to do this. And you're teaching somebody else how to do that. Well, it's because most likely you've mastered the basics that took for you to have that position. The most basics of the basics is the prayer and word, but it looks a lot more like what I've shared. And I forgot to bring the the handout or the paper that I had, so I had to look up online. Now, when we talk about head movement and we talk about the spiritual warfare being reduced down to really, it's God's truth and everything else. Why do you think they call Satan the father of lies? It's God's truth and everything else. And what does that look like? And so how do you apply this? And I have like a couple minutes to do this. How do you apply that? Well, you ever hear things like, you're such a sinner, or how did you do that? Or like, I can't believe he did that. I can't believe I did that. I'm so stupid, right? I'm so ugly. That person hates me. You know, I'll never be able to do that. Whatever it is. I'm sure you hear these slots all the time. But you know, the way that you can combat that is with God's truth. So he kind of gives an example. And this is taken from Bondage Breaker, Neil T. Anderson. Great book, great person that I would recommend. But he basically says, understanding your identity in Christ is absolutely essential for your success at living a victorious Christian life. And he breaks it down to Satan's lie. You're a sinner. You're a sinner because you sin. Well, God's truth says you're a saint, one declared righteous by God, who sins. You see the difference? And we know this because in John says, hey, listen, you guys shouldn't do bad things, but when you do, because you will, you have an advocate, and that's Jesus. So you're not a sinner because you sin. You're a saint who, unfortunately, because of our fallen creation, our fallen humanity, still has the capacity to sin. He says your identity comes from what you have done, right? You think about, oh man, if you knew all the things that I've done in life, whether that's, you know, drugs, alcohol, sexually, whether that's, you know, ripping people off or stealing, whatever it is, all the bad things you've done in life, if you only knew what I've done, and then you begin to think about yourself in that way, like, I'm never going to be anything else than that person, right? I'm always going to be this way. That's what Satan tells you. Your identity comes from what you've done. But what does God say? Your identity comes from what God has done for you. What did Jesus do? Well, he died for you. He died for your sins. All those bad things that you've ever done in life, the things that you keep hidden. You know, if I had the ability to put up on this screen everything that you thought since you woke up, you probably would never show your face in this building again. Or if I had the ability to show on this screen what you will be thinking or some of the things you've done in private, you would probably move to a different country where no one knew you. Right? But all those thoughts and all those things that you've done, all the words that you've said, Jesus died for you on the cross. Your identity comes from what people say about you. You know, especially in today's day, the social media influence, like how many likes did you get? What do the comments look like? I don't use social media anymore. It's become like this sort of, I have to be what people expect people to be, so I'm going to be fake, really, or I'm going to dress a certain way or act a certain way, say a certain thing. Why? Because I want people to like me. I want people to value me. I got to do this and I got to do that. I got to say these things. I got to act this way. I got to have this opinion. I got to do this. I have to be this political side, that political side. I have to, whatever it is. You know, that's what the devil wants. But what does the Bible say? Or what does the Bible teach, rather? Your identity comes from what God says about you. What's more important, what the world says about you or what God says about you? What does the devil teach? Your behavior tells you what to believe about yourself. No, it doesn't. Your belief about yourself determines your behavior. Well, how does that look like? In life, everybody wants to be accepted. They want to be secure, and they want to know that they're significant. That's everybody's sort of desire. In a core sense, they want to be accepted, they want to be secure, and they want to be significant in some way or another. And you know what the devil's going to do? He's going to make sure you believe you're none of those things. That's the head movement, right? That is the mental game, a mental war, that takes place every single day of your life. So how do you, let me see here. Before I move on and conclude really quick, what does that look like? Actually, let me go back to this one. Prayer and a word. What does that look like on an everyday practical? Well, you have to know what the Bible says in order to apply the truth to your life. You say, maybe you've been abandoned by your parents or an orphan, or maybe you've been abused by your parents or someone who was a guardian over you. And then you have this sort of like you have trouble with being accepted. It just happens. It's a sad reality that when people don't have healthy parents, they have trouble being accepted. But what does the Bible say? The Bible says that your God, that our God, is a good father. And you know what that means? That you're a child of God. So no matter how crappy your parents were, God is the one who loves you like a father. And you say, oh, maybe I don't have any friends. Maybe I don't have any friends. Well, what does the Bible say? The Bible says that God is your friend. All the bad things I've done, I'll never be able to make up for. I'll never be forgiven. That's not true. What does the Bible say? You've been justified. Romans 5:1. Let's see. I'm just picking some of these out that so I couldn't read them all today. Maybe you have trust issues because of people who've hurt you. Have you ever been hurt by someone that you thought would never hurt you? Abandoned, lied to, whatever it is. And then what happens? You're like, well, I'm never gonna trust someone like that again. You know, I'm never gonna let another person into my heart in that way again. Then what happens? You kind of just, you close up. You know, you decide never to be vulnerable with anybody and ever again because why? I don't want to be hurt like that ever again. That's just the human nature. But what does the Bible say? It says, I'm established, anointed, and sealed by God. It says, I can find grace and mercy in time of need. I'm born of God. The evil one cannot touch me. Let's see. What if you struggle with I can never be good enough. I'm never gonna look good enough. I'm never gonna have enough money. I'm never. That's not true. The Bible says, well, first of all, you're so significant that Jesus died for you. That the God of all creation chose to give his life for you. How more significant do you need to be? For him to say, I'm going to die for you because you're my daughter and I love you. I'm going to die for you because you are my son and I love you. I'm going to make sure that all those bad things that you did, you won't have to answer for them because I'm going to take that responsibility, that judgment, and I'm going to suffer for it so you don't have to. How more significant do you need to be to God for him to do that? Well, he tells you, hey, you know what? You're the salt of the earth. He says, you're my witness. And going back to the other verse, he says, I've chosen to dwell within you. I've chosen to take my spirit and your spirit and make them one. How more significant do you need to be if you're a child of God? So, in conclusion, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 9, verse 26 and 27, I box in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave, so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. You know what he's saying? He's saying, listen, I've chosen to live a particular life, and that life is following Jesus. And in order to do so, I have to apply certain disciplines and principles in order to do it well, in order so that I can survive in this world. In order for me, when I'm driving down the street and someone cuts me off and nearly kills the person in the other lane and causes a four-pile car backup, I don't flip out and go berserk on them. You know, like, listen, you could have killed these five people in a blink of an eye. You didn't even think about it. Or maybe when I'm, you know, like, and it always happens when you're alone. And I challenge you on this. Next time you're alone, maybe you take record, write this down, of all the negative thoughts that you think about yourself or the negative thoughts you think about others. Do it. I challenge you. Next time you're alone, record all the thoughts that you have negatively about you and yourself or about yourself and others and make a list of it. And then read that out loud. And then go to God's word and find out what it says about you. The next time you're alone, you're going to have negative thoughts about yourself. It's going to happen. So but I discipline my body and make it my slave so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. So the bottom line is this. The gospel is the power of salvation. The gospel is what's going to bring you into relationship with Jesus. And Jesus is the one who's going to be able to bring you through this mean and ugly world as it is currently, not as it's meant to be or was meant to be. And in order for you to survive, you're going to need to have that relationship with Jesus. So, worship team, you can come up. It's easy to get up here and to kind of like, you know, just say things. It's another one to actually apply them and to live it out. And I want you to know that, like, hey, you are all very special, every single one of you. And God knows that, if nobody else does. And if you ever find yourself without hope or wanting to quit or this world is too hard, I can't make it, all you have to do is pray this prayer. Jesus, help me. If I can leave you with one thing, if you remember anything that I've said last week and this week, it's this. Pray this prayer. Jesus, help me. That's all you have to do is call upon the name of Jesus. Jesus, help me. If you remember anything, it could be tomorrow. It could be 3 days from now. It could be a year. It could be 5 years. You're going to find yourself in a situation, and it's going to be hard. It's going to be very difficult, and you're not going to want to continue. All you have to say is, Jesus, help me, please, and he will. I give you my word, because that's his word. Father, I come before you in Jesus' name, and I thank you for the opportunity to be here. I thank you for the the people here, and I thank you for this church. I thank you, Lord, that this is a place that your name can be high and lifted up. That this place could be used by you. And thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here. I pray your blessings on this church and the people here. Lord, so clearly they've prayed for you to bring someone to help help lead. But Lord, that you would be reminded that they would be reminded, Lord, that you are just like when Moses said, hey, you know, God wants you to go up to the mountain to talk to him. And the people said, no, we want you to go up to the mountain and talk to him for us. Lord, I would ask that you remind them, listen, it's not a man to be a pastor. It's not a group of people. It's your spirit, Lord. It's your church. It's your will. And thank you, Lord, that you've given us the opportunity to serve and to be loved by you. So bless your people here. In Jesus' name, amen.
So as Chava was concluding there, I was thinking about the song that we're about to sing, How Great Is Our God. I love the fact, Chava, that you compared what goes on in our minds, what goes on in our hearts, with what God's word is. God is always going to be higher. He's always going to be greater. So as we sing How Great Is Our God, again, as Chava has challenged us, let's take those things that are lies, replace them with God's truth.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice.
Great is our God.
Through the battle, knowing that you are with us, knowing that it's you that fights with your truth. God, thank you that we carry that with us. And I pray that we will be keenly aware of your presence as we go. In Jesus' name, I pray.